Thank you. Now, today I will go back to my third year as a sociology student in the Middle East Technical University. I published a book. Now, I will start with that book. Now, actually, in the second year, together with my friends, we wrote a paper on two villages for rural sociology course. And then for the summer of second year, I did more studies in the villages. I will discuss this when we come to rural social structures. But today I will not talk about that part. I will talk about the introduction of the book, where I talk about Ottoman Empire and Turkish Republic, and how can we understand Ottoman Empire and Turkish Republic, and which concepts and theories we can use. Now, before I go into the concepts and into a debate, that was at that time in 1966. I was, as I said, second year to the third year. A book was published about Asiatic mode of production and underdeveloped countries. And I found that book. And in the introduction of my book, I criticized it. Now, I will come to that. But first, let me show you the title of the book. You know, maybe I can motivate you to do similar research. Now, I will go here and let me share my screen again. And here is the book. Now, let me see. Yes, as you see, underdeveloped capitalism in Turkey and its introduction, penetration into the villages. You see that there. Okay, and if I go a little bit down, you will see the backside of it and the second page. And then there is this foreword. And as you can see, the foreword is dated 1966, September 1966. And then I start this chapter, development of human societies, their functioning or the laws. Okay, at that time in 96, I thought there were laws of development of human societies. Now, eventually, I came to the conclusion that in human societies, only positivistic finding of regularities is not enough. We have to also understand their culture. So I modified my approach in the following 50 years. Okay, now let me send this away and talk with you. Okay, now the book that I criticized in this introduction on Asiatic mode of production and underdeveloped countries, was written by Sancar Divitçioğlu. It was a small book, actually. Now, my book is also here. Let me just just can show it. Now it is not very big, but it is 160 pages. But Sencer Divicioğlu's book was 30 pages, and there was a thesis. Now the thesis was that Asiatic societies, Middle Eastern societies, Ottoman society, Ottoman state and society, Indian state and society, Chinese state and society, were within an Asiatic mode of production. Now remember, from your second year, first semester, Marx and classical theories, classical sociological theories, a mode of production is a combination of forces of production, nature, technology, means of production, and relations of production, ownership of those means of production, land, factories, capital, or whatever. So when the two is combined, means of production and relations of production, mode of production. Now, again, you remember from Marx that capitalist mode of production is combined capital, factories, machines, the new technology, in contrast to feudal mode of production in Europe, where there were lords, aristocracy, owning lands, where the producers on the land, serfs were producing, and landlords were appropriating the surplus of those serfs, or they were obtaining rent, or they were obtaining corvée labor, forced labor, or maybe not, we shouldn't say forced labor, because it is regulated by traditions. Now, in exchange for a piece of land where peasants produce their subsistence, they have to work in the landlord's land for 4 days, 5 days, whatever. So they pay their rent in the form of labor, you know, or in working in the land. Anyway, and that was. Now, Marx also mentions Asiatic mode of production, where lands are owned by the state, and the peasants, producers, are on the lands, and instead of paying rent to the landlord, they pay tax. In Ottoman case, they pay öşür, one-tenth, aşara, it comes from aşara, one-tenth of their produce to the state. Now, we discussed this in the from Halil İnalcık, how the surplus is extracted by sipahi in the timar, where there are villages, and in the villages there are peasant producers, and sipahi obtains surplus extra by taxing the producers, and with a part of it he raises soldiers, and sipahi organization, of course, you know, there are many people, and sipahi has but sipahis are appointed by the state, and they can be changed. Now, these timars are added up to larger units, and then the largest unit is the province, vilayet, and beylerbeyi, vali, is presiding there, and he is also being appointed you know, by the center. This is the rural organization. So the difference between Ottoman and European was that in Europe there was lands were owned by the landlords, and producers were paying rent in the form of produce in kind, or in money, or in labor they were paying. Whereas in Ottoman Empire or China or India, producers were being taxed by the state. But they were all, in both of them, it was agricultural surplus. Technology were the same, but somehow extraction of relations of extraction of surplus or relations of production was different. Now, in that book, Ejetic Mode of Production, Sencer Divitçioğlu argued that Ejetic Mode of Production, that is, this taxing and the state being dominant and sipahis being changed, absence of private ownership. So the symbiotic relationship, in a sense, between the peasantry and central state and central bureaucracy, in a sense, prevented capitalist development in Ottoman Empire, in India, in China, whereas in feudalism, European feudalism, somehow the landlords, the aristocracy, and the merchants and traders and craftsmen in the cities, somehow a new dominant class emerged, which passed into capitalism. Now, my argument was that Sencer Divitçioğlu was giving as the cause of underdevelopment of Ottoman Empire, of Turkey, the internal dynamics, Asiatic mode of production prevented, he was saying, prevented capitalist development, industrial revolution. Now, my argument, but of course, my argument, I am a third year student, second year student, remember. I am arguing this because, one, Mübeccel Kray, the professor of sociology, the head of the department at that time, my one source, you see, I had urban sociology and rural sociology from her, and I used Niyazi Berkes, why, again, another Turkish sociologist, why are we underdeveloped for 200 years? There was that book. Yeah, I used that book. And also, I used İsmail Hüsrev. İsmail Hüsrev, village economy in Turkey, village, Türkiye köy iktisadiyatı, village economy in Turkey. And as a theoretical framework, I used Paul Baran's The Political Economy of Growth. Okay, so my thesis on the basis of Kray, Berkes, and Hüsrev, İsmail Hüsrev, was that while Divitçioğlu attributes underdevelopment to internal causes, Ejetic mode of production, I am attributing underdevelopment to domination by capitalism, earlier development of capitalism in Europe, and its expansion into first Southern Europe, and then eventually into Ottoman Empire, Russian Empire, even before Ottoman Empire, colonialism in India, the merchant companies. Of course, before that, European expansion into Americas, Latin America, North America, and coming of gold and silver from there, and an inflation, et cetera, now, because of that, so you see, this is already 15th century, 16th century, the discovery of Americas is 1492, Christoph Columbus, remember that, okay? So already in 15th century, European economy started influencing while capitalism is developing there, influencing the rest of the world, because there is an international trade between India, China, and Europe, which passes through Ottoman Empire, Bursa, and Istanbul, and other cities in Ottoman Empire. So this external dynamic of colonialism and imperialism is the reason for the underdevelopment. It is not Asiatic mode of production. Anyway, the mode of production of Ottoman Empire should not be understood as Asiatic mode of production, but as a variant of feudal mode of production. Feudal mode of production in European feudal mode and Asian feudal mode. That is what I was thinking at that time. In a European feudal mode of production, it is the landlords, it is the lords who own the land and get the rent in kind or in money or in labor. Whereas in the Asian Ottoman variant, it is the state organization of the state which gets 10% of the produce of the agricultural producers. Okay, now I modified it later. Now I will come to that. I modified a more abstract concept of tributary mode of production and European feudalism and Asiatic mode of production being two variants of tributary mode of production. I will come to that. But now I will go to, my book was in 1967. I will go to an article by Halil Alcık. We will come across Halil Alcık several times. We already did because he is the historian of Ottoman Empire. Really, he does research. He goes into the archives, analyzes them, brings them into light. So now, in 2 years later from that book, in 1969, Halil Alcık published Capital Formation in Ottoman Empire. Capital Formation in Ottoman Empire. And he's talking about 15th century, 16th century commercial capital. Okay, now again, you know, just be familiar with this, you know, just see from where I am now. I will be discussing with you this article, but see the article yourself. Let me show it again by sharing the screen, and you will see how these. Okay, now here. Let me share this. You will see. You see, Cambridge University Press, Journal of Economic History, 1969. You see it? Yes. you see it there. Okay. Now, if we go down, you will see capital formation in Ottoman Empire. You can enlarge it a little bit. And how he goes into, you see so much footnotes explaining the sources. For example, giving a reference to Kınalızade's Ahlaki Alai. Anyway, I will not go into that detail. Now, let me send this away and let me summarize this article. Now, Halin Alcık says that organization of agricultural production and getting of taxes, resources, or surplus, if we use again the that terminology, surplus in agriculture, and in handicrafts and in commerce. Okay, actually, one of the sentences is this from Halin Alcık. In discussing the ways of making capital or mal in Ottoman, the Muslim jurists agreed on three principal ones. From three principal sources, one can make capital, mal, commerce, handicrafts, and agriculture. Okay? And then he goes into how agricultural production is organized with the timar system, which we already discussed, sipahis and timars, and up to a bureaucratic, a patrimonial bureaucratic organization. The crafts are also regulated by the state in the cities through guilds. Whereas the merchants are left relatively free to accumulate capital. Now, although they also have guilds, but they don't. The state does not regulate that guild, like state regulates the guilds of the craftsmen, the guilds of the. Okay, he does not. The state does not regulate. Now, how does he come into that conclusion? He went into the Tereke defterleri for historical study in the archives. You know, Tereke defterleri is one of real source. He translates that as registers of effects, registers on effects. Now, from there, he find out that the merchants, tüccar, tacir, are divided into two. Tacir is seffar, sefer, traveling, those who are engaged in overland caravan on land or sea commerce, traveling merchants. Taciri seffar and taciri mütemakkin, being a center, having a center and doing commerce from a center. Okay. Now, in these archival sources, Halil'in Alcık found, for example, that that merchants can form a shirka, a kind of firm, and actually the Muslim textbooks, in the textbooks, it deals with this, how various types of partnerships can be formed, and how commercial transactions, including money transactions, murabaha, and credit transactions, riba. Okay, now he goes into this, and then he goes into how merchants can accumulate, or also some other people in the cities can accumulate on gold and silver, and it is being allowed by the jurists. It is a legitimate way of accumulating by gold and silver. They are called mal ribawa. Now, these are being discussed in nasihatname, advices to the merchants or to the rulers or to the subjects of the state at that time. Now there are tujar, are merchants, but there are also sarraf, bankers in a kind. In the later periods of Ottoman Empire, Istanbul sarrafs lending money even to the state, you know, is famous. I will not go into that. You see, these are all in 15th and 16th century. Now, although so far I am talking as if in Ottoman society and other Near Eastern societies, in Muslim societies, capital accumulation and capitalism, commercial capitalism, has no obstacles. No, but not all sections of the Muslim society are favorable to commercial capitalism. For example, in earlier days, Karmatiya, and in Ottomans, Malamatiya and Bayramiya, and Sheikh Bedrettin, for example, in 15th century, the end of 14th, the beginning of 15th century, and Al-Ghazali, the famous jurist, Al-Ghazali, were against, they were hostile to capitalist mentality. And this is from archives, this is what Halil'in Alcık found and reported. So in from there comes how, for example, neutral term at the beginning, madrabaz came the implication of profiteer or trickster, a negative, pejorative term. It becomes a pejorative term. Okay, now, you see, he goes into this institution of hisba. Now, hisba, the duty of hisba is how state supported guilds and hence it fulfilled duty of hisba. Now, what is hisba? In Islamic states of the Near East, certain ancient and traditional rules intended to protect the interests of the population by preventing profiteering, tricksters, profiteering, fraud, speculation, usury, tefecilik, usury, had been taken over by the religious law under the name of hisba, so that their application had become one of the principal obligations of the state, Muslim state, that is preventing profiteering, preventing usury. Hence, this is now again a quote from Halil İnalcık. The leader of the Muslim community was obliged to fix a just price, and so he observed, and it was with this particularly that Hisba was concerned, punishes crimes, all types of speculation. Now, merchant capital, in a sense, involves speculation, especially in that gold and silver accumulation in gold and silver. In this article, Halil İnalcık goes into, again, archives in Bursa, Edirne, and Istanbul. And, you know, these are three cities in the international Silk Road trade, you see, which is still continuing. Although in the meantime, Europe is finding a different route going down to African continent, and as south and south and south, and then going to east, going south and east instead of going from Europe to Ottoman Empire, to Istanbul, or to Bursa, or to Edirne, and then going to Persia, and then India, China, etc. Before those routes were being discovered, the merchants were mostly in Bursa, Edirne, Istanbul. So he goes into the archives in these three cities, and he finds these, the findings that I just summarized. But in addition to merchants, there is also another way of accumulation of capital, which is which can be in land as well as in commerce, vakfiyya. He talks about how vakfs are set up by means of vakfiyya, a kind of charter in which are laid down the object of the vakf, its source of income, how this income is to be spent. Of course, the vakfs are established for charity and other public services, but they became at several times also means of establishing private ownership. You see, state is trying to prevent private ownership in land, allowing private ownership in cities for the merchants and for the craftsmen and traders, but regulating them through guilds. At times of decentralization, when the central state becomes weak in agriculture, landlords emerge. We discussed this when we were discussing Michael Meeker, the anthropologist. Yes, remember? And vakfs become also the ownership, private ownership. So in a sense, when I said the tributary mode of production being one more feudalistic, that is landlords, the lords owning the lands. Now, in this decentralized period of Ottoman Empire, starting from the second half of 17th century and 18th century, there was this decentralization and development of landlords, and how peasants are now working for the landlord and paying a part of their produce either as sharecroppers or as in labor form, etc. Okay, now at this point, I would like to go into an article by Huri İslamoğlu and Çağlar Kaydar. And then I will come back to Çağlar Kaydar's book, State and Class, and the first chapter and second chapter. I will continue from there. But before I come back, I go into the summarizing of the first chapter of State and Class of Çağlar Kaydar's book, which will be one of our main textbooks, really, while discussing Ottoman and Turkish Republican transformation. But I will go now into an article published in 1977. You see, 10 years after my book, which was published in 1967. And this article is published in 1977. Now, the title of this article is Agenda for Ottoman History. Agenda for Ottoman History. Again, you know, to make you, you know, to see from where all this knowledge is coming, from an article, from a journal article. Let me show you again by sharing my screen and where there is this article from which I will be summarizing. Okay, now. Now, how here we are going. Why am I not able to do this? Okay, now let me do it again. Let me go here and let me go to this. And there is something strange that tamam, okay, I did that. Now, good, here it comes. Here it comes. Here you see again in a journal review. The name of the journal is Review Fernand Braudel Center. You see, 1977. Huri İslamoğlu and Çağlar Kaydar, Agenda for Ottoman History. How to study Ottoman history? What can be a conceptual framework? So let me go down a little bit so that you will see. You see agenda here. Critique of the present paradigm. Okay, now he's remember in one of our courses in earlier weeks, I talked about Bernard Lewis's The Emergence of Turkey, or Halil İnalcık's, okay, the article we just discussed, but they are giving reference to the Ottoman Empire, and Gibb and Bowen's Islamic Society and the West. Okay, now they take these three books and how they conceptualize Ottoman Empire's social structure and state structure. I summarized that, especially in Aljuks. They say that it is a Near Eastern conception of state and agricultural production, commerce, and crafts, and it is not dealing properly with Ottoman history and its decentralization, that is development of a kind of feudalism during 17, 18 centuries. And then in 19th century, or starting from the middle of 18th century and during 19th century, how it is being dominated by Western capitalism. That is, they use the word peripheralized, how Ottoman Empire is peripheralized. In order, now let me send this away, I am already summarizing, how we can understand better by having a more elaborate conceptual framework. And they say this conceptual framework is the concepts of Asiatic mode of production. But they use Asiatic mode of production in a different sense than Divicioğlu. They are not trying to understand, or they are not trying to impute a causal relationship between Asiatic mode of production and underdevelopment of Ottoman Empire or Indian or Chinese, but rather what were the dynamics of transformation or equilibrium of Ottoman in Ottoman Empire? How can the illuminated, illustrated with this concept of Asiatic mode of production? Now they borrow this concept. Of course, now one source is Marx, but real source actually in 1970s, Althusserian sociology, structuralist sociology, is dominant in the West, in France, and it started influencing Turkey as well in 1970s. You know, I am a witness to that. Some of the books of Althusser is being translated. Now, you will remember Althusser's theory as a structuralist macro-sociological theory of modes of production, of capitalism, where economic way of extracting surplus is dominant, whereas in a pre-capitalist societies, in pre-capitalist societies, non-economic ways of appropriating surplus. Okay, these non-economic ways is in feudalism and in Asiatic mode of production is political. So it is not an economic means of appropriation, but it is through political domination. The you will remember in Althusser, mode of production and social formation are differentiated. Mode of production is the underlying structure of historical concrete social formations. They don't use society because the concept of society is together with the nation state, okay, in later periods. Now, the concept of social formation is a concept to be used before the emergence of nation states and societies. How one mode of production under the dominance of one mode, or a combination of modes of production, a social formation is being structured. So actually, they are saying that Ottoman Empire, in the Ottoman Empire, in contrast to Europe, although in Europe as well as in Ottoman Empire, means of appropriating surplus of the producers, peasant producers, or craftsmen, or whatever, is political in both in Europe and in Asia. In Europe, it is through the lords, whereas in Ottoman Empire, it is the state who uses political means of organizing agricultural production, crafts production, and traders and merchants. Although, as we have seen already in Algip, merchants are relatively autonomous to accumulate capital. And then İslamoğlu and Kedar goes into the Sipahis, the Timar. It is how the Sipahis are tax collecting, but the Kadı, the judge is appointed centrally, and hence they are not appointed by the Sipahis. So there is in the classical period, there's a check and balance between Sipahis using political means of extracting surplus from peasants. And if there's some injustice, the Kadı is intervening. They go into that. And they also go into Hispa, which we already talked in the Ottoman social formation. Craft production was undertaken by guilds and strict state regulation. Hispa, we already talked about this Hispa, and they actually give reference to Halil Nalcık's accumulation of capital accumulation in Ottoman Empire. So actually, they say that the Ottoman state, starting the beginning of 14th century to the middle of 15th century, actually, it is a kind of European type of feudalism. There are soldier families as lords or beys, as beys, beyliks period. And only gradually the central state gained power, and especially after the conquest of Istanbul, Constantinople, Paul, the formerly Byzantine lands and villages, which were already appropriated by the beyliks, and they talk about how these beyliks, there were intermarriages between the Roman, the Byzantine lords, and Ottoman, no, not Ottoman yet, the Seljuk, okay, they are extensions of Seljuk Empire into Anatolia, and how a kind of hybridization was taking place, huh? They go into this, and then, as we discussed earlier, how with Fatih the Conqueror, Mehmet the Second, the conquest of Istanbul and conquest of all Beyliks gradually, and then extending it to the following after Mehmet the Second, Mamluks, the Syria and Egypt and those lands on the one hand, while Ottoman Empire is expanding towards Austria, towards Vienna in the east and south, expanding into the Middle East, so the classical period, and then how starting 18th century, again, like in 14th and the earlier part of 15th century, now in the second part of 17th and 18th century, how again a feudalization, how again landlords emerged, and instead of sipahis taxing, appointed by the state, the multezims, tax farmers, now state subordinate, giving away tax collection to the merchants who from the beginning pay some amount to the state, and then they collect it from the peasant. Yani it's a complicated type of feudalization, and the emergence of ayans, and how again they talk about different cities in Ottoman Empire, etc. Okay. Now, I said that I was very critical of ascetic mode of product, the concept of ascetic mode of production, and I was saying that together with actually Niyazi Berkes and Vecel Kray, Ottoman is a variant of feudalism. Now later, as I already said, I came to revise this, especially when I read after 1982 a book by Erich Wolff, anthropologist and historical anthropologist, historical anthropology of globalization or expansion of capitalism into the world, into the rest of the world, really. In this book was titled Europe and the People Without History. Europe and the People. Now, when I read this book, I discovered that Erich Wolff talked about three modes of production. Okay? One, kindred mode of production, kinship-based production. All, okay, anthropology studies, preliterate, tribal, clan-type societies. Okay, so Europe expanded into those lands. The second, tributary mode of production, Europe before capitalism, and Asia, Ottoman Empire, India, and China, tributary mode of production. And within tributary mode of production, a more landlord extraction of surplus and tax, so rent and tax. But as two variants, but not as the difference between them, I thought in 1966, was very little. But later I came, Çağlar Keyder's and Huri İslamoğlu's arguments about Asiatic mode of production, and Eric Wolff's arguments, when combining these two, includes also ownership of means of production. So it is not just surplus extraction, but the difference in relations of production, although it is the same, although the means of production are same in both, the type of extraction of surplus, political means are being used same, but ownership is state ownership in Ottoman, Indian, Chinese, the other one, private ownership. Now, that might make a difference, but this is how Eric Wolff discusses, he goes into Iberians in America, the fur trade, slave trade, all those, and then he comes back to Europe, industrial revolution, crisis and differentiation in capitalist, the movements of, you see, that is really a book that I used in some of my courses in Middle East Technical University. But before I go back to Çağlar Keyder's first chapter and to the second chapter, the first chapter, 10 years later than the agenda for Ottoman studies, studying Ottoman in 1987, the book, State and Class. Now, 10 years passed, and he uses in the 10 years how he conceptualized the classical period and peripheralization. I will come back to that. But before doing that, I also would like to show you an article by Talal Asad, which is published in the same year that Çağlar Keyder's book is published, in 1987. Now, it's a review and criticism of Eric Wolff's book, Are There Histories of Peoples Without Europe? Now, what was the title of the Wolff book? It was Europe and People Without History. Now, Europe dominated peoples in tributary mode of production and kin-ordered mode of production. So Europe appropriated their history, made them without history, because they became part of European history. But Talal Asad is criticizing that with this title, Are There Histories of Peoples Without People, Without Europe? Of course, before European capitalism, there were histories of peoples, especially in tributary mode of production, in history of Ottoman Empire before expansion of capitalism into Ottoman, or China, 5,000 years of history of China or India, or Near Eastern histories. So Talal Asad goes into a criticism, and he again criticizes subsuming European feudalism and Ottoman, Indian, Chinese, Asiatic mode of production under tributary. Now, tribute, he goes, is mainly taxing. Does it include also the landlord sharecropping with the peasants or using their labor or getting in kind or in money? No, it is not that simple. And then he goes into, and he says, instead of these general and abstract conceptualizations, it is better to go into detailed sociological, anthropological studies to understand these dynamics and their transformations. So he says that now Wolf opted for these trinity of modes of production, capitalist, tribute, and kill. Instead of extravagant typologies others have produced, indicates a sensitivity on his part to the dangers of dogmatic historiography. Okay? Wolf's three modes are not simple classifications. The capitalist focuses on dynamically interacting processes of production. The tributary isolates a politically sanctioned relation of wealth extraction, and kin ordered emphasizes a way of organizing labor of kinship relations and concept of mode of life. Wolf's account invites possibility of asking questions that might lead to different writings of history of societies that Europe conquered and dominated. He quotes from Wolf. He says that now these three modes does not exhaust the possibilities, because for other problems and issues, it may be useful to construct other modes, drawing further distinctions. This flexibility, and being an anthropologist, and Talal Asad being also an anthropologist and historical sociologist, he is sensitive to that. And then Talal Asad goes into a detailed analysis of this taxation in the tributary mode. For example, he quotes from Wickham, a historian of medieval Europe, who argued that the basic distinction between two forms of tribute taking, rent and tax, rent taking and tax raising, and respectively, rent taking is called feudalism, tax raising is called tributary mode of production. He maintains that can be found in this in the same state. While on the one hand there is taxing, and there is on the other hand appropriation through rent. For example, in capitalism, he says, it is not only economic means of extraction of surplus. Remember again, Marx's analysis of laborer and the capitalist, how labor is commodified and bought by the capitalist, and laborer in a working day produces his own wage plus some surplus, But this is economic, this is appropriated as the profit of the capital and the capitalist, and then it is invested. But in the same capitalist society, there is also taxing. This tributary taxing versus rent should be questioned. It should be problematized. So this is what Talal said, problematization of these abstract modes of production analysis and going into more historical, sociological, anthropological analysis. Of course, making references to theoretical constructs as well. In anthropology, theoretical constructs and abstraction is less than in sociology. In sociology, you can make more abstract conceptualization, or in economics, maybe more abstract. If you think of concepts used by the economists in their analysis of economic action. I will now go back to chapter one of Çağlar Kayder's Class and State. In this chapter one, as I said, this is 10 years after, in 1987, 10 years after 1977, Agenda for Ottoman Studies, did together with Huri İslamoğlu. Now here in this chapter, he starts with a discussion of a continuity or discontinuity between Byzantine and Ottoman. Okay? Now in 1453, okay, Mehmet II conquered Istanbul. So the capital of Byzantine Empire became now the capital of Ottoman Empire. We discussed about this, the building of the palace and the organization of the palace in such a way that the Sultan, Sultan's gaze, remember from Meeker, is within the palace as well as in Anatolia as well as in Balkans. Okay, now he asked this question: is there a continuity between Byzantine way of organizing agricultural production and getting the surplus for the state, for the ruling non-producing groups, classes, okay? Now, it's a debate, the debate between is there a continuity or discontinuity between Ottoman and Republican? Now, it goes back, and is there a continuity or discontinuity between Byzantine and Ottoman empires? Now here, some historians, social scientists, like Fuat Köprülü, one of the founders of history, a national history in Turkey, and Taner Timur, more Marxist-oriented historian, they both say that no, there is no continuity. Ottoman Empire, between Ottoman Empire and Byzantine, there is no continuity, but there is a continuity between Ottoman Empire and Seljukid Empire, the previous one, between which Ottoman Beylik emerged and developed into a state, an empire. And Seljuk Empire is a combination of Persian, Arabic, and Turkic traditions of statecraft, and Ottomans appropriated it. But then Kedar argues that now this might be true for two centuries of Ottoman Beylik, yeah, before it became, it conquered Istanbul and became an empire. So it's a more of a extension of Seljukid traditions of statecraft conceptualization of how a state and the sultan should act, etc. You know, there are nasihatnames and political political books, politics conceptualizing politics in the tradition of Near East, from the Arabic Islamic sources, from the Persian sources, and from the Turkic sources. But Kedar says, but after the conquest of Istanbul, Mehmed II conceptualized Ottoman state, Ottoman centralized state, along the lines of Byzantine organization. Of course, there were also the Seljuk part and Islamic part, but the land structure, this timar, the villages, and Sipahi, there were similar villages and a Byzantine lord appointed by the Byzantine Empire, not privately owning the lands, but state ownership and getting the tribute, getting the tax. So he is saying that in Anatolia and in the Balkans, and this is the Eastern Rome, you see, Western Rome collapsed in 5th century with invasions, etc. And out of that emerged cellular feudalism in Europe. Okay, whereas Roman Empire continued. Roman Empire continued in the East as Byzantine Empire. Now the difference between the two is really okay, it is the same empire in the West Europe and in Asia, in the Middle East, in the Near East, okay, but in Byzantine 1000 years, you see, Byzantine Empire lasted 1000 years more than Western Roman Empire, where the dominant language was Latin and Catholic Christianity was dominant, whereas in Byzantium, dominant language was Greek and Orthodox Christianity, Greek and Orthodox Christianity. You see, Western Rome, Roman Empire, and Eastern Roman Empire were differentiated from each other, although it was initially for how many, maybe for 500 years they were together, but then Western one collapsed, but Latin language and the languages that emerged in hybridization with Latin and Hun or the Roman and other tribes, invading tribes, and so Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, French emerged, and then Germanic languages of English, English and German and Dutch and etc. You know, that is the European development. Whereas in Eastern Rome, in Byzantium, Greek is the dominant and Orthodox Christianity. But eventually, Arabs and Turkish tribes moving into the lands of Byzantium and eventually transferring of the center, conquest of the center, Istanbul, Constantinople, and appropriation of those lands and those villages, populations, who are already started being hybridized, this time with the Greek and Turkish. No, some people, for example, spoke Turkish, but they were Orthodox Christian. Some other people spoke Turkish. I already said that. Turkish, but Greek Orthodox, or Turkish or Arabic speaking and being Muslim. You see, there is all this hybridization. Now, he says that we should conceptualize not only discontinuity like Köprülü and Fuat Köprülü and Taner Timur, but also not only discontinuity and continuity with the Seljuk, but also a continuity with the Byzantine and Ottoman. And he finds Inalcık agreeing with him. That is both influences, the Byzantine influences and Near Eastern Seljuk, Arabic, Persian, Turkic influences. He says, for example, that this is one of the in post-Byzantine, Helena Turkic entity in Ottoman Anatolia, embracing Near Eastern civilization, similarities in cultural material such as music, food, festivities, daily life, and even folk religion. There were continuities from Helena Turkic hybridization. So during Ottoman conquest of Anatolia, decentralized vassal principalities, beyliks, under the domination of powerful military families. So a synthesis by intermarrying Byzantine principalities and Islamization of Anatolia through mergers, and only after the conquest of the capital, how Byzantine Turkic beyliks, magnates were confronted and centralized, and the magnates, the beyliks are eliminated, and a centralized state emerged. You see, in the previous, before this centralization, peasantry were, from 11th century, 10th, 11th century starts to 13th to 14th centuries, even to the middle of 15th centuries, peasantry gradually became dependent on landlord. And trend was towards feudalization. But Ottoman conquest of Istanbul reversed this trend, and centralization gained power and arrested the development of landed aristocracy similar to Europe. Thus, classical Byzantine land code was realized. So this a continuity here. Land became state lands again, and labor services to the landlords or by the peasants, paying rent in labor services were abolished, and independent peasantry was restored by centralized Ottoman state with usufruct right and bureaucracy taxing them. You see the classical Ottoman structure came into being. And this is a good summary. And then he goes into how after 1550s, price inflation started distorting taxing system, and pressures for decentralization started, and how landlords and bandits emerged, and state functionaries pressed for further autonomy, with the decentralization, and peasants again came under the control of the landlords, a feudalization again, but European influences started in the second half of 16th century, especially during 17th century, price inflation. So some peasants became serfs of the landlord, or some peasants migrated to other villages and they became independent producers and paid proportional tax. These landlords, some of these landlords started forming coalitions with other landlords and creating larger units and also being dominant in the cities. So this is 18th century. Finally, in the beginning of 19th century, the Senedi Ittifak in 1807, Selim III signed this Bill of Union, this Senedi Ittifak with these ayans, and re-centralization started, but re-centralization along the western lines of state organization, of bureaucracy, of rationalization on the one hand, and the interests of merchants and capitalists in Ottoman lands, granting of monopolies, which started already in 16th century, and more monopolies giving to European merchants. Okay, now he goes into this. This is a process of, he calls this peripheralization, and how with this re-centralization, Latin American type of a landed oligarchy did not develop in Ottoman Empire, and instead a central bureaucracy together under the dominance of European powers and capitalism, how Ottoman Empire accommodated to the world capitalist system. Now, in second chapter, he goes more into detail and compare this accommodation with Japanese and Chinese modes of relationship with expanding European capitalism. Now I will take off.